everybody. How are you doing? I am Cinnamon Cooney, the Art Sherpa, and today I'm going to show you, yes, you, how to do this leaf with these realistic, lush, droppy water drops in every single step you can need. Now, check that eye card, because even if you think you could never possibly ever paint a realistic water drop, I have a really quick drill down 10-step lesson on how that's done in the eye card. Click that, it's also in the description below, as is materials, where I like to hide them, below that more button. Of course, we're gonna show them to you before we get started, but the most important thing I want from you today is a little bit of optimism. And if you're feeling a little bit optimistic early, you could go ahead and hit that subscribe button or share this awesome video with your friends. All right, let's get started. The first part of this painting that I did was I sketched in my leaf that's in focus. I want to remember where all of that is. So when I'm doing this nice bokeh background, which also just means blended or blurry, I can really, really see the sharp and crispness of that leaf. I'm going to begin this painting with a number 10 bright and start just laying out the values that I have in the background. So the first thing that I'm going to do is put in these blurry shapes that I'm seeing. I'm going to pull out a little of my cad red here, and I'm going to add a little orange to it, but I want it to feel a little grayed out and a little far away. So I'm going to do an interesting thing. I'm going to get just, look at how little blue I'm getting. I'm coming from the edge here, and I'm just putting a small amount on the brush, and you can see even a little bit really impacts this. Adding my blending so that it will be soft and easy to work with, and I'll start putting in this interesting, soft, faraway color. The other reason it can be important to gray these background shapes is so when I put in the crispness of my focused leaf, it really, really pops. I'm just softly brushing this on, just creating a nice layer of color. Now I need a little more of this a couple places. And I want to plan that out so that I can make sure I'm constantly working what we like to call wet into wet, which means that I'm going to be blending soft edges. I'm going to sketch in with paint. I don't have to be that specific. I don't even have to be good at drawing a distant shape of a leaf here. And paint that in with this first interesting layer of paint. I personally very much enjoy blended backgrounds. I think that they're a lot of fun. But they can be very intimidating if you're not sure how they're constructed. I'm really hoping that what happens is that by seeing how we put this on together, how easy these types of backgrounds are. Now I'm going to come and get a little green, and I don't have to rinse my brush even at all. Let me even grab a little brown, because this is, again, a distant color and is in the background. One of the tricks about this is going to be blending and softening the edges between these two fields of color, and I'm going to show you a great way of doing that. First, we have to get it all painted in. The tool that's going to help me do this blend is both this blending medium using the glazing medium that I have, and also a soft dry brush. This brush is dry, has no paint on it, and is very soft. So you can see when I brush those two edges together how well they blend. And I'm going to do the same over here. Now this is important to have a clean, dry brush. If you have a lot of brushes, you can change out brushes a lot during the painting. But if you don't have that many brushes, you'll have to rinse this and dry this between segments. Don't worry about it too much. You'll be okay. Looks like we need a little more green. And it's even deeper. I might add some blue to that to darken that even more. And come on this edge right here. Just following along my little leaf, painting this in with this dark edge. I really enjoy blended backgrounds. They are a lot of fun to create. Now grab your blending brush and soften this edge right here. So to the eye, it'll seem blurry and out of focus. Now I'm going to do an interesting thing. I'm going to get just a little of my yellow paint, but notice that I haven't even rinsed my brush yet. A little white to it. And that's because the muddying or graying of these colors will help with the effect of this background. Painting around this sketch right here. Painting right around it. All right. Let's blend these two zones a little bit so that they're soft and not in focus. And right about now, I think I'm going to have to wipe this brush off on my towel and also wipe its friend, the number 10 I have loaded with all the paint. The colors all through here are going to be quite dark again. So I'm going to get my burnt sienna and my phthalo green and a little of this blue to make a very deep color. I'm going to let some of it come up into my green. I want these to blend and mix. Just blending this right here. Right up. Just creating a nice blend right here. We'll have to come back with another deeper color, but acrylic painting is always about layers. And usually I think what happens to people is they don't know that and they're in the middle of the painting doing just fine and they just get frustrated before all the layers happen on the painting. I'm going to wipe my brush off and just soften this as well. This is foundational for everything that we're doing. I'm going to soften out these brush strokes just a bit. Wipe it off. Don't worry about it. You can use an inexpensive chip brush, lots of different brushes to get these effects. All right, now I'm going to have to make another grayed out orange here. So isn't it nice that I already have some green on my brush? That's going to make it easy. I might even gray it out a little further with that smidge of blue. Again, you're noticing that I am doing these in small amounts so that I have control over what's happening. I enjoy putting this stuff in. It's a lot of fun for me. I really enjoy painting. Makes me super happy. Something to keep in mind. I move very quickly in my lessons for two reasons. One, that's now my natural painting speed. And because I also have to keep within certain time constraints. But you don't have to worry about those things and shouldn't. Kind of soften the edges here, and that will help blur the space between these two objects, even pulling the green pigment up into here. Go back and get some more green if you need it. I do, so I am. Every time I grab that glazing medium, what's really nice is it extends the drying time of my paint and allows me to glaze. And that gives me a lot of flexibility in getting the result that I'm looking for. Now I'm going to rinse out my brush really well. start putting in some of the fun blurred effects and colors that make this background so whimsical and romantic. I'm pulling out a little of the yellow, adding just a smidge of the red to it to get an orange. Maybe add a little white and then the glaze. And right in the center of this leaf, I'm going to add some to the edge here, some down the center. This is the color of this leaf. Go ahead and maybe put a little bit of this yellow here as well. Wipe your brush very well. Make sure it's dry. Doesn't have a lot of pigment on it. Go ahead and soften and blend this paint as well. Soften this here. So a trick to this is to use a very soft, gentle brushstroke that dances on the edge of these bristles. If you've applied makeup, it's a lot like that. Or if you've had to dust something very delicate. If you've ever collected dinosaur bones, you would find yourself surprisingly good at this activity. I'm going to come here and create some of our fun background blending. I haven't rinsed my brush. And I'm going to create a little spot here. Maybe a little spot here. Just a little bit. Say this has some dappling light. Maybe fill in the whole corner. It's pretty nice. Put my brush down. Make sure this brush is pretty clean and still dry. Blend these little spaces and shapes out a bit. Just creating this out of focus, multi-tonal background. Pretty fun. I'm going to add some of these right here. Get a little more white if you need it. Just a few places. And even some down here. Now the thing that I have, again, I know my paint is going to dry a little slower than traditionally. So that's going to help me a lot. Just blending it out. Blending it out. Softening that space. Scrumble if you need to. What you need is to create dimensionality to what you're looking at. This area needs some of this. Rinse, 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 rinse. But very dark. We need to create some deep tones in here. And to get that, we're going to pull out our green and our brown. See, pulling that out from the edges here, green and brown. Come and add some of that blue. That's quite deep. Right under this leaf. Let's be sure and add some different focal depths. Might grab this one to be more brown and some different tones that we're layering. You'll find that this really, really helps with the depth and dimension of your piece. Make sure that this is still quite dry. And then just softly brush this. This will work as long as the paint is wet and the brush is clean and dry. If you're finding that this isn't working well for you, it could be that your brush has too much paint on it. Sorry for those moments when I'm thinking and I stop talking and then start back up again. It's a very weird thing that happens when you're painting and talking. All right. See, that's looking really good. Maybe add some of that dark color up here that you just have on your bristles, and it's a good way to clean it off. So this is really feeling quite good, but I need to create some color depth here. And then I'm going to show you a really fun trick. I'm going to pull out some of my yellow and some of my red. Smidge of green, because I don't want it to be too bright, but I definitely want it to be in this range. And I'm definitely going to come and add some more space to what's happening here, and even include some of this here and a little bit underneath right here. Get some more if you need it. You can even pick up a smidge of red. Pretty fun stuff. Right here, just diagonally down. I bet you're predicting what's next. I bet you know. Do you know? Don't let this stuff panic you. It's just about layers. If things go weird for you or your paint dries, remember that you can just paint over dry acrylic paint as often as you feel like you need to. Now, I have a small heart stencil that I created. A stencil is anything that has a shape that's cut out that you can paint into. And I'm going to create some little lighting effects with that. I've got a nice number 10 brush with natural bristles that are kind of scrumbly. And this is going to let me pull out some of my white paint. Just get a titch of blue. Not a lot of blue in it. No glazing medium, interestingly enough. And you're going to just create some lensing. Move the direction of this around a bit. If you need to get some more white on there to create some variables in how bright the lensing is, you can do that as well. You could use a round circle that you cut out of paper. You could use an octagon. I just happen to like hearts. I think that they create a lot of happiness. And maybe one down here, just lightly. See, as the paint is lighter on my brush, the hearts get a little bit lighter. And that's kind of fun. Get a little more white. Tuck that into the corner there. Layer that up. I think we've got some effect there. And that kind of expresses what we're talking about. Really, we're here to paint a water drop. So I'm going to put my brushes in water and get those rinsed out real fast. It's important to not let the acrylic paint dry on your brush. If it does, don't worry. If it's dried a short amount of time, you should be able to wash that off with just brush soap. And if it's dried a long time, you can get it off, believe it or not, with rubbing alcohol. And that includes hand sanitizer. Because rubbing alcohol breaks down dry acrylic paint. All right, I am going to get a really nice number 8 bright. It's just a little bit smaller, and it's going to give me some control over what I'm doing. I'm going to paint my first dark color in on my leaf. To get that dark color, I'm going to take a little of my phthalo blue and add it to my cad red. It's going to be very dark. I'm going to paint up my stem. And you might be surprised if you didn't ever see this before that blue and red don't always make purple. And that's really about the undervalues in the paint. Like, is this paint a little more yellow or blue? And that can really impact this. So what I'm doing here is I'm going to just paint in the entire leaf with this phthalo blue cad red mixture as my base. That's what I'm doing. Thaler red, cad red mixture as my base. Want you to hang in with me. Don't give up. You can do this. All you gotta do in a painting is complete it. It's not about how perfect the painting is. It's just, did you get it done? And you can do this. The nice thing I like about painting on boards is that they're very inexpensive and they're very easy to paint on. Very, very easy to paint on. It's okay in this first layer of paint if you're seeing a lot of brush stroke here. You've got so many layers to do. And acrylic paints are not like oils. So you don't have to worry about expecting them to be like that. They're going to be a little different. And that's okay. You're going to like how things are different sometimes. Just enjoying painting along. My leaf very, very in focus. My background not very focused. I may need to create a little light right there. We'll have to see when we do the drop. Sometimes you have to make decisions while you're painting. I like to make decisions while I'm painting. Same, you're just working the paint. I'm just getting all that white covered. Sometimes the canvas fights back and you gotta wrestle with it. Wrestle it. Wrestle it. Here I am. Wrestle it. Also sometimes called scrumbling. I have wrestled my painting. Now I have a nice deep value that I can build my whole leaf on. Right? And so I've got to start building that up. I'm gonna rinse out my brush because this leaf is actually quite orange. You're going to find that that purple helps anchor the orange that we're about to put on there really beautifully and also becomes a really great shadow mixture for those realistic water drops. I'm hoping you're enjoying this lesson so far. I really enjoy teaching it to you. The number one thing I want you to do right now is remember to hang in and get this all the way to completion. It's all the layers that pull this together. If you like lessons like this and you want to see more like it, be sure and hit the subscribe button and share it with your friends and tell us what you think in the comments below. So I'm going to start layering my brighter and brighter colors up. And my next one I'm going to get to enjoy making is a much brighter orange. I'm going to take a little of my yellow over to my red. And when you add just a little bit of yellow to red, you get a very dark orange. And I'm going to come to the upper edge of my leaf and kind of dry brush this bright orange in. I'm letting a lot of my purple show through, and that's because I want to make the illusion of something being very alive and having great depth. So a dry brush with a lot of color showing through can help me do that. I'm gonna get some more paint. Now at this point, I'm kind of avoiding where I have green, and that is because green would gray this color out and I want it to be quite bright. Because the wonderful thing about this leaf, this particular beautiful leaf, is that it is quite bright. And I'm just gonna keep painting that color on, letting the purple resonate through. Pretty fun stuff. I may need to put out some more paint soon. If you need to put out more paint before I do, don't wait on me. It's like, don't hold up dinner on me. You put out what you need to. Don't worry about me. You're going to notice that my brush doesn't just leave a uniform one-tone color out. It creates lots of different little micro mixes on the canvas. That is in my benefit, and I'm really grateful for that as an acrylic painter. Helps me a lot. Sometimes new painters fight that, but once you've been painting for a while, you'll be like, oh, that's helping me. So see, we've got some nice dimensionality here. And I'm going to come down this center. I'm going to pull some just yellow and a little bit of white. I haven't rinsed my brush. Just down the center and a little arc on one side of my leaf vein. My imaginary leaf vein that I see in my mind's eye. See that nice little curve line? I'm going to very softly blend up this yellow space. I don't want it to be even. I want it to be very up and down. Because if you think about how paint loses its color over time, I've got to find some yellow over here. I need to put some yellow out. I found my yellow. It's right here. I'm really grateful for it, and I need to put a little more red out. Don't put out too much paint because your paint skins if it sits out too long and it wastes paint. You want to put out what you need. Sometimes I have to put out a little more than I would like for these lessons just so it shows up on camera, but you don't have to worry about those things. Grab just a little more yellow onto my brush this time, and I'm just defining that. Tabbing the little edge here, up and down. Oh, I really enjoy that. It's such a beautiful color. And lightly, lightly dusting it out here. And just very, very light dusting of that yellow. Like to put a little spot of that here. Might grab a little of my glazing. Glazing is nice because it lets you do very translucent runs of color. And that can help you when you're painting. Coming here, I'm going to leave the center here where my vein is darker because it would be. And come down and match it out. And pulling my yellow out a little bit again here, but a little more blended. Blending never hurt anybody. I don't know that that's true. Maybe it did once. I didn't get the memo. But mostly I have a belief that blending doesn't hurt you. All right. Now I'm going to get a much stronger cad red. I'm going to tint it with the little yellow still. These are hues I'm going to enjoy putting this next layer on my leaf. I'm just pressing very, very lightly, letting the color distribute off the brush. And painting this leaf another bit. Now you're starting to see what I mean about these layers building up, building up, building up. That's what we're doing. We're just building up these layers, pulling a little yellow, much more red into it. I might come back and knock that back a little bit. Just pushing that out. Just making that multi-dimensional leaf start to come to life. And that's what you're going to want to do. Start to bring this leaf. Maybe bring this down into the stem. I'm going to grab a little of this brown. Come right down the center here with it. Go ahead and grab a little of the brown too. Maybe work a couple little places on this little leaf. Give it some color. Give it some character. Scramble it around. Find your space with that. Maybe a little more yellow. just layer, 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 layer. So I feel like my leaf now has lots of sort of fascinating, wonderful fall colors. And I'm going to have to get a little bit of a detail brush to sort of pull in some little detailing resolution to this. And I'm going to look for a small brush that I'm going to have a lot of control over, because that's going to make this project much simpler. Oh, here's one. It's a little beat up and worse for wear, but this is a number two shader. Shaders are, they look like a little small bright, but they're actually pretty helpful at what they do. I'm going to take that little yellow-orange mix and come over into the white. You may want to add some of your glazing to it for flow improver. Just right down center of this leaf. Why don't you run that little vein? It comes down here. Light. Very, very light pressure. The trick to this, where you get these light veins that you can barely see, is just pressing very lightly. I like to think of these as like little road maps. Right? One little will come out here to this little tip of the leaf. And if I see too much of the color, I just lighten my pressure. And you don't need to have veins all over the leaf, just a couple places where you think the leaves kind of might have been running a little circulation out to them. Keep it mellow. You don't want to interfere with your drops later when you're doing them. So this is a detail that you need to be very light and not too heavy-handed with. Hopefully I'm not being too heavy-handed. You never know. Art is not about being perfect all the time. Even experienced artists are not perfect all the time. Sometimes there's things that we all kind of just work on and do. So I've got a little veining here, and I really like that. And I'm going to start putting in my water drops. So the first thing that I'm going to do is, do you remember that purple we made from earlier? I'm going to make that dark purple again with a little bit of blue and my cad red. And it's not really purple, it's almost a brick color. But what it also is the shadow that the drop would leave. And I'm going to first do the crazy drop in the center of the leaf that has the interesting shape. So right here, up past where I feel like my stem and all of that would be, I'm going to draw this little shadow. Right? Get glazing medium if you need it. It will help improve your flow and help keep this wet a little bit longer. Out here, sometimes drops aren't circles. Sometimes drops do crazy things, but they still obey similar little rules of light and reflection. And so you can create some neat effects when you want to show water effects on something that you're working on. Now I'm going to come right here. Bring that in. And come out a little bit. This also helps me know where all those effects are going to be. Sometimes water drops are a little bit of work, but gosh, they're a lot of fun. And I'm really glad we get to do them. Let's put a nice big fat drop right here. This is a nice big fat raindrop that landed right there. Maybe it has a little friend here on the edge of this little leaf. Because these are rounded in the way that light shines through them, sometimes they'll have little shadows around the whole edge. Just another little fat drop, and it even went past the little leaf point here. It's shown up. We're just doing these little fat drops where we see them and enjoying them. And also where we would like them. Sometimes in a photograph, it will have more drops than you want or less drops, and you won't like the kind of drops it has. And the wonderful thing about being an artist, little drop, little drop, little drop, is that you get to decide. You decide. The drops don't decide. You decide. Right? Maybe a nice drop right here. It's been a nice rainy day. This plant is super happy. It's a very, very happy plant. Now we're going to have a drop coming right off this leaf here, but we're going to do it outlined in white because the way light shines through the drop when it's shining through, it's called lensing. And we'll cover how to do these. So, what you need to decide about your drops is where your light source is coming from. And you can always tell that by reflections and shadows. And so, since I know from looking at the reflections on my water drops that the light is coming from here, I'm going to need to put a shadow in the opposite direction. Let's put those in now. It's going to be a lot of fun. Not a lot of a shadow, and I'm using my glazing medium. And that's because the light isn't at a deep angle, it's just slightly at an angle overhead. And so you just want to anchor them a smidge. You don't want to confuse the viewer. These are just a smidge, not too much. Remember, water is see-through, so you're really just painting the reflections and the shadows on your water drops. Not really anything else. And I think that's what messes with people a little bit. I'm looking here and I feel like we need just one right there. Sometimes you'll do that. You'll be like, oh, I just want one more. And that's okay. That's your prerogative as an artist. Lots of interesting stuff happening here, though. So the first shadow that I'm going to do, once I have defined this a little bit more, get that glazing medium, some nice paint flow. So I'll work just a soft glaze of a shadow. This is just a small amount. Try not to be heavy-handed with it. Me too. It's not, I'm talking to myself. You think I'm talking to you, but I'm actually encouraging myself. Don't be heavy-handed. I probably will be. I probably will be. Interestingly enough, because of the nature of water, I've got to come right here and also include a little bit of a shadow that's happening. And a little bit here. We're going to work out the definition of these things as we define these little drops. Now, unset your brush for a second. We're going to help ourselves a bit with a light glazing of a highlight. So pull out some glaze and a smidge of your white. Not a lot. I like to just maybe do just, oh, less blue than that. Wipe, wipe, wipe off if it gets crazy. You just want a tint. This is a subtle, subtle process. And I'm making sure that I've got, I'm going to add this right here. Where I know I've got it, putting this in. This will help me later when I'm doing my drops. It just helps me know where it is that everything is going to be. I know I've got a highlight right there. Right there. I'll make a little bit stronger highlight later, but right now I just want the soft glaze of it just right here. Just so I know where it is. There's another little light area that I've got to deal with. But this is the reflection on the surface of the water that I'm trying to talk about. And that is going to be very important for me later so I don't get lost. Just putting that right there. Reflecting up. Reflecting up. Just this reflection. This is an important reflection. Here's another little reflection right here. This smudgy drop has reflections on several surfaces, and it's about being able to paint those in. Don't let it stress you, though. It's just light. Light's got to do what light's got to do. It's got to come to these drops, and then it's got to... Ooh, I forgot some of the... Let's add that there. It's got to move on its way, right? And we don't worry about that stuff because there's principles. I know I'm going to have the light coming here. I'm going to have a little light at this far end by the shadow and a little shadow by the light. As long as I remember those little formulations, I can't get that lost. And remember, if you check the iCard, there's a whole video on realistic water drops. So if any of this feels weird or confusing or awkward, you can go back and watch that really quick video again and you'll be like, oh yeah, I got it. So never worry about it because we're going to make sure you have all the information you need to complete the project. All right, let's keep painting. So we're just going to keep putting those in, these reflections. Now, these at this stage just need to be strong enough for you to see it, right? Just for you to see it. They don't have to be perfect. The next part that we're going to do is we're going to go back and we're going to think about our little shadow again a little bit. Just a small amount. I'm going to make, interestingly enough, an orange. But it's going to have a little of this purple in it. What? Wait, crazy. Yeah, I know. And I'm going to come from here on my shadow to here, curving up, and just lightly glaze a slightly deeper color around where I know I have my reflection. I want the painting underneath to show up really well. I always go the opposite direction of where my shadow starts. So if my shadow starts here and here at the halfway point, the convex shadow will be above it. Super simple. So let's come here and add this shadow above where the art, where, so what happens is if you watch our other video, here's the reflection. You know the light is traveling out here. It casts a little shadow down here. Light is cast back into the drop here, and then back here is another shadow. We know where to start that by where this shadow begins. If this shadow starts here and here, then I just arc up. It's opposite shadow in the drop. I know, your mind's blown, right? Let's do this through all of our drops. This is slightly orange with a little bit of purple. Be sure you have glaze so it doesn't dry out on you. And also you want what's there to show through. All right, so the shadows here and here, I've got to shade the drop right there. It's not big, it's subtle, but it's a big difference in your drop. If you have to remake a little of your purple, do that to add to your orange. Glazing where you need it. There, right here. See, I'm putting it over the top. Now I'll come back at a later date. With a little more highlight even, if I need it. See this long one? I just remember where my shadow is. And curve that. I can always come and get my reflection put back in as I need it. These are starting to look a little more like water drops. How crazy is that? Trust the process. Just a little bit. Similar glazing up here. It's subtle, but important. Along here. Just a little bit of the glazing. There we go. Isn't that crazy how that creates that space? This is going to pop between all the highlights and the glazing. Now, another weird little place on the center one you're going to want to concentrate a smidge of a shadow is a couple places along here. Just a little bit, not everywhere. Just along a couple of the light lines. There you go. So that's a small amount. Rinse that off. Now what I'm interestingly going to do is I'm going to pull out a little of my yellow and a little of my white. This creates sort of a light color. I'm going to pull out my glazing. You might need to add a smidge of orange to it. Well, it's cad red, making orange. Yeah. And then we're going to come right here. Glaze that in. Just a little bit of color. Maybe a little more yellow on this one, I think. Just a little bit. You're going to come back and add highlights to these. A little more white this time. But I keep the glazing up. Because I want my leaf to show underneath. If you have too much pigment, you can always wipe it off on your brush. Curving this over a little bit. Just dusting. See, I'm just dusting. A little bit. Little more pigment than I have there, but not much, man. Oh, too much pigment. Does that ever happen to you? Just me. Alright, just blend that out. Stress over it. It's a big drop. Curve this. Just make sure everything is nice and soft. There we go. We got a whole bunch of little water drops that are just happening on our little leaf here. Just soften any edges. You don't want hard edges. So see how I'm scrumbling here? That's what you want to do. You want to scrumble, and you don't want any hard edges. Where you need it, scrumble it. Just blending, 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 blending. And it makes a difference to soften. It does make a huge, huge difference. Now I'm going to come with a bright highlight. This is much more intense than anything I put on. Just along here, I'm going to run a bright white highlight. And then maybe there's one right here. Tap, tap, tap. This bright one. I know I've got a bright, bright, bright one here, but I've also got a couple little ribbons happening here. This is light coming in and light going out. Right there. So see, now that's starting to feel a little good there. Let's got a little on the back side here. Just dusting a little misshapen one right there. Again, not too worried about it. They're just fun. And you can just do them. Now, something that I would love you to do, if you can, I'm going to get a number 4. And we're going to go back to our little orange that we made at the beginning, which is the cad yellow and the cad red. Put a little glazing medium on it. I want it to be quite to the red. And we're going to just, right here, soften this and blend this out. Because if it's too defined, it can ruin the effect. And that's something that you've just got to constantly be looking for in your painting. Is where do I need to repair anything I'm seeing? And then I can refine here with some green. I don't want to rinse my brush because I want it to gray out. I'm going to take my burnt sienna and my burnt umber, and I'm going to come just underneath this. Make sure that I have defined my stem a little bit more. Get the glazing medium if you need it. Blend this out wherever you need those definitions. I might even come on the top end. Give those definitions. And blend wherever you can. Blending, 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 blending. So that's me. We all have to make little decisions. I'm going to also soften out that stem a little bit with my cad red and my yellow. And define that some. Take this highlight out a little bit because it's pulling my eye the wrong way. Maybe that happens to you sometimes. Oh, I got to fix that. I got to change that. That's okay. Sometimes we have to. Like to add color sometimes when I see it. All right, so I've got these drops. I need to do one little drop off the tip. And I'm actually going to get that same shader out. But this time, I'm going to use just my white. Little glazing. Just my white. To define it. And I'm going to pull this right off. Very thin line. Very thin. This is maybe the most fun, the whole piece. Put some white right there. Now I'm going to come and get my orange that I mixed. A little of my red, a little of my yellow. Right here in the edge. Going to add just a titch of this color, curving along the inward curve, and then coming in a little bit. Then I'm going to come and get my phthalo blue and my phthalo green and make an incredibly deep color. It's right here. Get a little of your yellow. Just a smidge in that drop. Now, a little of my white. Going to be just right here. Pull that defined down a little bit more. There. And then if you can get a glaze of it, it's just a thin glaze, go ahead and create a little reflection right there. So now you have a realistic water drop coming off. You have bokeh. You have drops. Totally painted a relief in focus with water drops. What a crazy thing to do with your time. I hope that was fun. I hope you enjoyed that. I hope you find these water lessons interesting and helpful, and maybe they're unlocking the mystery of how to paint things that you totally see through. tips that I want you to remember. Stuff up close looks like a hot mess. Back away from your painting about 12 feet. I'm not even kidding. You really should. You should back away from your painting about 12 feet and take a picture. That's going to give you an idea of how well you're actually doing. Because sometimes when you're right up on something, you're like, oh, because you can see every brushstroke. You get too close to things in your life. You get too close to things in your art. And they're not as beautiful as they actually are. So it's always good to take a step back, breathe, and relax, in my opinion. If you love lessons like this and you're totally blown away by the way you were able to paint water drops today, be sure and hit that subscribe button and tell your friends. I mean, share this thing everywhere. I would really appreciate it, and I would really appreciate seeing your art. So you can find me, remember, in all those links in the description below and also on my channel, lots of social media. I want to see what you've done. It's always exciting to me. I always appreciate it. I hope you will just keep painting no matter what. I love you, care about you, and want to see you at the easel really soon. Bye-bye.